If you wanted to tell the story of Napa Valley Cabernet in the past couple decades, Fred Schrader's story would be a perfect way to do it. Fred came to Napa Valley in the 80s and began to attend the Napa Valley wine auction. He got the wine bug there. He and his wife, Ann, decided to get into the wine business with Colgan Schrader Cellars. Fred and Ann parted ways, and suddenly Fred was faced with prospects of starting over or heading back to Florida. So his story is one of renewal and determination. I set out one time to figure out how many different individual bottlings of Napa Valley Cabernet there are. And I kind of quit it at around 1,000 or 1,100. That's how competitive it is to try and get in that arena. And so many people are trying to make the best Cabernet in Napa Valley. And getting to the top is a very, very combative exercise. Fred Schrader's been there twice, with Colgan and his own Schrader Cellars. So let me introduce Fred.
So for 98 and 99, I had a winemaker and we had a vineyard and we tried our best, but things weren't going in the direction I wanted. And I went to Barron's and Hitchcock up on Spring Mountain and did a cellar tasting. They were gracious enough to let me try all their barrels from the 99 vintage. When I tasted this one barrel, it was like an epiphany. It was unbelievable. It was just like, good God almighty, where did this come from? So I asked them, I said, so what barrel is this? You know, how's this fit in your program? And they said, oh, that's from To Kalon Vineyard down in Oakville. Andy Beckstoffer owns it. So I got in my car and about 100 miles an hour, drove down to meet Andy B. I said, well, Andy, I'm interested in getting some grapes from To Kalon Vineyard. He says, Fred, you just come on in here. We can take care of that for sure. So signed up, and I met this guy here. So it was his attention to detail, his compassion for wine, his completely devoted to seeing what a great product he could make in Cabernet. And Thomas had never made a Cabernet in his life when I met him. He had only made Zinfandel and Syrah. So I said, well, what the hell, we can give that a try. So we're up on the porch at my house, we shook hands, and that's the only contract we ever had. He started making wine, and he immediately knew intuitively what it took to make a fabulous Cabernet Sauvignon. And you know, it's not rocket science, but it's so much attention to detail. And you have to be totally consumed in what you're doing. And that is what Thomas Brown does. He is the ultimate master at reading a vineyard about when it needs to be picked, what the sugar level should be, what the cleanliness in the cellar and every single aspect of the winemaking process at the winery, what the toast in the barrel should be, how long they should be in the barrels, and if something's a little funky at one point in time, don't panic. Just let it figure itself out on its own. Where a lot of people would jump in and say, no, you know, I'm gonna fix this, I'm gonna fix it. Well, the fact of it is, it's gonna fix itself, and that's why every vintage we've ever had has never been manipulated. It is pure, natural winemaking process. So that's the key to what you're gonna drink here. That's what we're serving.
So To Kalon, historically, I think is over 500 acres. And Davi owns a majority of that. Andy Beckstoffer owns 80 plus acres. So because Fred got in there early, we were able to jump into what we always thought were the better blocks. And so every year, there would be someone who wouldn't renew their contract. And we would jump in, we'd walk everything that was available. And that 80 plus acres that Andy owns, Fred and I slowly whittled that down to about 16 acres. And without seeing a map, it's really difficult to explain it. But there's sort of this crossroads in Andy's vineyard we think is kind of the tenderloin of To Kalon. So we basically focused on all those different blocks. And even though we could taste the difference in the wines because we tasted them all the time, people kept asking, you know, why don't you just put them all together and you know, make one big wine? And I think from a sales perspective, Fred realized that wasn't going to work. But also from a flavor perspective, we did see differences in these individual blocks.
The most important thing in a wine is how it finishes, and that is how long and how true the flavors are in the aftertaste. So pay attention to what you get on the finish.
Well, we tend to taste backwards into the wine from a winemaking perspective. So the main thing for us is the quality of tannin. So you get tannin in these wines, you could measure it empirically, and it would be a X number of tannin. But the crucial part for us is the ripeness of the tannin. So we pick everything on flavor. And I think you see that expressed in the entry, middle, and finish for these wines. There's grip there, there's plenty of body, but there's nothing in the flavor profile that gets in the way of the finish. So your first impression of the wine obviously is aromatic, your last is the finish, and we like to focus on those two bookends just to make for as a complete experience as possible. And talking about clones, CCS is clone 4, the RBS is clone 337, and the Sparky's a mix of clones. I think you see it in the expressed in the RBS, that clone is a much brighter clone. So you see more red fruit. There's some savory elements coming up, but it's still mostly fruit dominated. The CCS being a darker profiled fruited clone, you're seeing more things like black walnut and tobacco, which again, to me, as a frequent drinker, kind of a volume drinker, I like these wines.
Heavy drinker.
Yeah. So I got Jim to put that quote in the article, actually. That was my greatest achievement with that article. So I like wines that are complex. I like wines that stand out. And that's why I tend to approach these wines, too, when they're about a decade old. And then for the Sparky, for me, the most complete, also holding the most in reserve. Y'all have probably seen the bottles. They're all magnums. So the format also makes the wine show a bit younger. And I think you can see the differentiation in these three wines, and you can see some of the rationale behind bottling all these separately as well.